All right, so this is another installment of SQL related presentations. Today, I'm gonna go over SQL injection union attacks. So I kind of shamelessly took this from the Portswigger references. So a lot of this content seems very similar. It's because it kind of is, but I'm gonna try to explain it a little bit so that you don't have to read through a whole article and it's a little bit more digestible, I hope. So first off, what is union in SQL? So as with most SQL attacks, we are using SQL query language, and that's normally what we're going to be kind of constrained to. So the union for union attacks is specifically just normally is meant to allow you to execute additional select queries within an SQL query. So something that would look very similar to say if you had an injection, or no, if you didn't have an injection, sorry. But it was just used normally. And actually, this is wrong. There should be a select here. But it would say select user pass from users, union select address state from users. So what I'm doing here is I'm selecting two different fields from the same table. But what I'm doing is I'm able to concatenate them into effectively the same like output because they're now considered as two columns for both of those outputs. And then we're doing a union, so we're just telling them, hey, you know, just become part of the same result. They can be appended in the same columns. That's like the main thing to keep in mind. This isn't you can't do like say union and then if you're say on another type of if your database has like extra features, like you can't just like union and then call like a command exec. This is purely to do additional select queries. So if you want to compound queries, you can do that. So they must have the same number of columns and they must have the same data type. These are something that we're going to come back to when we're actually trying to go about this union injection or this union attack. But first, what is a union attack? Well, we're making use of that how like union keyword works to retrieve other information from other tables in the database. Databases normally have more than one table. I mean, maybe they don't, but I would say for a lot of models, they might, because if you say you have like a user login and then you have you're also using a database for, say, subscribers for some platform service, you know, you can have additional things that you're using that database for. And so you're going to have multiple tables that are in that database. And so maybe through just a basic injection that may not necessarily yield the information you want, you might be able to make use of that injection to go leak other databases that have information that you do want. Some things to keep in mind though, is that we want to make sure that we are keeping with the same columns again. So this is the problem that I was talking about before, that is a constraining value for union attacks. And we also want to make sure they match the same data type. SQL has this concept of data types. These are things like such as maybe ints, booleans, character strings. These can vastly differ just depending on what type of database table has been created. This, of course, is depending on the schema that's been used, but we're not going to be leaking any schemas or anything right now. We're going to be purely focusing on just performing the attack. So the first method for actually finding the amount of columns that we're going to be dealing with is using the order by syntax. Order by in SQL, it just allows you to basically tell us some output from the select query. We want to then order that statement by, you know, whatever number we give it. So if it's able to say order by one, the output say is even two columns, we should still be able to do order by one because we can get that single value from that output because there's one column that has a row of one values. If it was to be say like transposed from vertical to horizontal. For two, if you say like order by two, then it's a similar idea. So for like the last one we were looking at here, we have two columns here and we can order by two. We have one, which is the first column, and two, which is the second column. So this is really nice for trying to figure out not only just, you know, how many columns are in a table, but if I want to make sure that my query output is matching what I'm expecting, it's more of kind of like a, I would say you could use it as like a, almost like a guess and check, or, you know, given this output of the order by statement, do some other thing within the query, within the database. Like this is for like actual implementations, but for our purposes, we're just going to be using it to figure out how many columns are in the output. So if we have this basic SQL query here, where we are just saying, you know, for ID, the meme from the meme collection, we want to look up the name that equals whatever the user has supplied us. The injection here comes in where we actually are able to slide in that order by statement, and we'll say something like order by 3 and say that if it's from that same table that we were looking at before, it only has 2 columns. So we can't actually order a third column out of that. So it's going to error, and that will know, that will let us know that we've actually hit that limit of, you know, maybe we've gone too far. We might get something similar to this, or we might get like a response that says, hey, backend error, something's really wrong here. But in blind SQL injections, you won't get this information from there. So sometimes doing union attacks in blind SQL is a little tricky. It doesn't really work as easily. But on the side of non-blind SQL, this is a lot of times what you might come across is just some weird undefined behavior, or at least the database is telling you, hey, this ain't right. Something's wrong here. The second method is using union statements. So with the union attack, we can not only just use it for leaking data that, first of all, we don't know exactly how many columns are yet and what types, but we can also use the union parameter to basically help us figure out how many fields there are, or how many columns there are in a database or in a table. And what we can do with this is we can union additional select statements together. And for each of these select statements, we can tell it, you know, for a given location, for a given field, just set it to null for now. And we, in SQL lang, you can select null from a location because null is a valid type. It's kind of a type that's seems to be more of like a base type for a lot of things. And so if you try to select null, it's not going to error out, but it won't necessarily return anything for your table. So sometimes people might do this too in their queries and their code to denote more of, for the developer side, you know, how many fields exist in a database. And this is so they can go back later and be like, oh, okay, well, null was there, but I know that there's supposed to be a field there. I can, you know, change that if I actually want that field to be returned. Otherwise it won't be returned. It'll just be returned as null. And then I'll only grab the field that I'm care about. But for us, it's really helpful because, you know, you gave me that same injection, we can do something similar where we can just say union select null, and then you can string together a bunch of nulls as much as you want until the database starts erroring out, because we can select null and then we can select null. And then the moment you try to select that third null, then it's gonna error and be like, whoa, 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 there's something wrong here because we don't have an equal number of expressions in the target lists. So this would run an error on that table that we were just looking at before. Now the data type, that's gonna be the next important part. Now we can figure out what the size is, we also wanna figure out what the data types are. So like I said before, we have things such as strings, integers, booleans for the data type fields in an SQL injection. For union, we can do something similar to what we were doing before, where we were, you know, selecting the X amount of nulls out of that statement to basically get the server to die, or to at least for error. And once we figured out, say, you know, for whatever given table, it was 4 values of columns, then we can start trying to inject values into those locations to figure out which one doesn't return us an error. A very simple way to do this is to kind of do what's seen here. So we're actually just taking this string literal A and just moving it along to different fields until we end up having a problem or it actually accepts. So if it has a problem, then we know that field doesn't work with A. And so we'll just move over to the next one. And then we can put an A into that location. And then, okay, cool. So we'll know that we can have a string value at that location. And the reason why the type is important is because, like I was saying, not all tables have the same type. So if I'm trying to leak from some injection point where maybe it doesn't have the data I want, but the values in that location, say, are a mixture of strings and integers, if I try to leak, say, from a user database that which has passwords and usernames that are both strings, I may not get the proper output. So that means that I have to figure out something that exists in the current table I'm in that has a string, and then be able to then chain that together with the other table to then try to manipulate my query in such a way that I am throwing specific string fields into the areas that are only string fields and not at those integer fields. The type of kind of error you might be looking for is something similar to this, where obviously it's not going to work correctly because the character value can't go into necessarily like an integer location. So something along those lines is something of what you're probably going to be messing with and looking for. I am going to though switch to a demo real quick because I was using a lot of PortSwigger stuff. So some of the PortSwigger information that is online also includes a lab. Let me share that. Does anyone have any questions so far? Am I going too fast?
So that one part where you're talking about finding a field that you can use to sort of sound like output the password, I was a little lost there.
Yeah, here. I can help that a little bit.
Okay.
Because yeah, it is it can be a little confusing, and I may not be explaining it the best. So if we have a table where I might, that's horrible. We'll go like this. And say I have three columns here, and one's an int, integer, one's a string, and then the other one is a string. But in the original query, I'm only using these two columns. So I use my union injection to figure out, okay, are there any additional strings, any additional columns, and or what types are those columns? So that in my user database that's over here, which has a username and password, that is, are both strings. I then find out that, okay, well, obviously this is a string, this is not a string. But then in that union query, I was able to figure out that this is also a string. So now what I can do is I can union select statements together that might potentially lead up to allowing me to grab values from here, since now I know which values from this table can actually output additional fields from this table. Actually, I think, you know what? I'm sorry. That's wrong. This is wrong. Yep. No, this is wrong. I'm really sorry. That's a good point. That wouldn't work.
No, but so, according to your definition, I think the way you could probably do it is because you have that S. So we're probably going to use that S for both the password and the username is my guess, right?
Yeah. So you would use something like chaining them together in this specific column because this one right here would be an integer. I'm sorry. I explained that really wrong. I was leading down some wrong thing. Anyway. Okay. I guess that makes more sense then.
Okay. No, but this helped a lot because now it's like, okay, that's what you have to do if you have mismatched types or the data type that you need to leak only comes from one of the fields, and then you have to sort of take that into account, basically. Use what you have.
Yeah, and like instead of using a comma to chain together, so if I have like user, I know it's poorly written, and then pass.
Uh-huh.
There's a technique to, instead of in that select statement using a comma, you can use in certain query languages for like, say like MSQL, uh-huh, or I mean MySQL, sorry. You can actually do a pipe, a tilde, a pipe, and then the pass parameter. Ooh. And then what that's going to output as in whatever this field is going to be located in, it would then output as the username, tilde, password as one value. Nice. And so that's how you'd be able to input it into, say, like one of the columns, whereas the other one wouldn't necessarily be able to have it.
Awesome. Perfect. Awesome.
And then the demo that I just am going over is quickly just a one to show off how to get the fields. So for this one, you kind of have a nice little thing where you can look over the different categories. The injection point, which I'll kind of skip to, is right up here. So we have a category here where we can look at something called corporate gifts. If we put just like quotation mark there, it gives us an internal server error. So we know there's probably some sort of weird injection that's there. And now what we're going to do is try to figure out how many columns are in this location, because currently we know that there are, you know, we can kind of guess that there might be at least two because there's a name and a price. But there might be more columns that we just don't know of because some of these might use more than one. It seems like they don't, but but let's check. So we'll do union and then select. I'm just going to do null. And then that seems to give us a server failure. And we'll just kind of keep doing that until we get one that works. Cool. So it looks like there's three. So now we can do that using union. Otherwise, with order by, order by's output's a little weirder because when you do order by one, it'll output correctly. But like say, so we know it was three fields, but let's do order by four. Well, now we know that there's an internal server error. So that's when it errors out. But now if we drop it back down to three, it outputs correctly. So basically you just can keep going until it errors out, and that's how you know that it's failed. And then you can continue using a union selection to then do a union select, and then whatever the field is that you're looking for from whatever table. So for some of these labs, actually, let me go back to, there is, so we can go to this library here for using an SQL injection to retrieve data. So for this one, we're going to have a table called users, which contains user and password. We're going to solve the lab, perform a union injection, and so on, and use the information to log in as administrator. And so on the lab here, we're going to be using a similar technique to where we're going to be trying to figure out what tables exist on here. And it's a very similar interface to what we're originally dealing with. So same categories, so probably same injection point. We can verify that to you by it erroring out when we enter in the quotation mark there. And I'm going to be doing union select null, and then that. And it should be, I think, three again. No, maybe two. Oh, I hope if I spelled null correctly. Okay, so it was two that time. So cool. So now we can select username. I believe that's what the lab description was saying, right? So it should be username, comma, password. Yep, username and password from the table users. Select username, password from users. And there we go. Now we can see that we have the administrator password and the administrator name that we knew as administrator. And we can go log in as that user. Well, helps maybe if I copy it. I might have copied it incorrectly, but yeah, that's kind of the gist, I guess, of the like the union attack, is just the fact that we can chain together additional things, leak out information from other tables, and be able to then use that information whichever way we want. Anybody have any more questions? I do apologize again for that misexplanation.
No, that was great. Thanks.